Welcome to Your MSC, and we are about to have a fascinating conversation with the man behind MSC, the Munich Security Conference. I'm here with Leroy and Fonseca, of course, but more importantly, with Wolfgang Ischinger, who is the former German ambassador to the United States and London, and has also been the chairman of the Munich Security Conference since 2008. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's a great pleasure to be here.
So I wanted to ask you a little bit about your feelings on the event this year. There's a lot of moving parts, a lot of things happening. How do you feel about the execution of it?
Well, let me start by saying that, you know, the world is not in good shape. Mm. The international order is in terrible shape. We have, as everybody knows, I guess, we have broken the world record for displaced persons and refugees, 70 million, something like that. That's terrible. As we sit here in Munich, and I keep reminding my guests and speakers of that, people are actually dying in places like, you know, Yemen and Syria and Libya. So we need to create a sense of urgency and a sense of stuff that needs to be done, not just speeches that are going to be made here and without any follow-up. So if you ask me, how happy are you with this? I am confident, well, I should say I'm very hopeful that this conference will have, when it's all over, will have produced some impulse, maybe encourages some of the actors to move a little bit in the direction of a compromise rather than confrontation. That would be my hope. And, you know, what's also part of our mission is to offer a relatively easy platform for people who normally find it very hard to visit each other's country, because that is often seen as a difficult step. You lose face by going to see your adversary. So they come to Munich and they meet here. I'll give you an example. The president of Azerbaijan and the prime minister of Armenia, they have a conflict called Nagorno-Karabakh, which has been going on for practically 30 years now, where people are being killed all the time.
Right.
Not in huge numbers, but people die. So yesterday we organized a session for these two, and both of them told me this is actually the first time we show up together anywhere. Mm. I mean, I think they had met in some large conference somewhere. But this is the first time they actually exchange views and debate more or less publicly. So that's a very important step, because without dialogue, diplomacy can't work. And the same thing is true for the relationship between another conflict couple, Serbia and Kosovo. President of Serbia met here in Munich 2 days ago for the first time, the new prime minister of Kosovo. These guys need to talk to one another, and they do, and that's good.
The conversations and negotiations are so important. I agree with you. Have you seen actual follow-up or action after the event? Maybe some real negotiation following the Munich Security Conference?
Well, I've seen that in the past. For this conference, it's a little too early to say. As we speak, the meeting of foreign ministers on Libya has just concluded. I don't really know, because it just ended like 10 minutes ago. I don't really know whether any meaningful concrete steps have been agreed at that meeting, but I hope that that was the case. In the recent past, we have had such success stories. I'll give you one. 11 years ago, 2009, Joe Biden, then the new Vice President of the United States, came to Munich and literally, on stage, pushed what he called the reset button. The reset button for the relationship between the United States and Russia. Hmm. And that was an initiative by the Obama administration. That reset button included the beginning of negotiations about strategic nuclear weapons, called New START. And you know what? 3 years later, on the floor of the Munich Security Conference, the New START Treaty, which is very important because it reduces significantly the number of strategic nuclear weapons which could kill the whole world 10 times over, the new START treaty was actually entering into force because the two sides, Russia and America, exchanged the treaty documents on our stage. So, yes,
wow.
That was a good step to which we contributed the neutral platform.
So when it comes to these bipartisan, or I should say bilateral negotiations, Fonseca noticed something really fascinating yesterday. Fonseca, do you want to jump in and talk about it?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I was fascinated because this is where all these deals are happening, but you always hear about them on the news, but you don't know how the sausage is made. Let's assume, I don't know, that I'm the foreign minister of the foreign affairs minister of Iran, and I want to meet the secretary of state of America.
Yeah. Who will say no?
But how do I do it? Because, I mean, I don't think they have their phone number on WhatsApp.
Oh, no, that's
like,
easy.
How do you arrange that?
That's easy. We have all the numbers because we have invited
that's
these people.
That's pretty powerful.
So
yeah.
We have, of course, we know who is the delegation secretary for, let's say, Secretary Pompeo. We have his chief of staff. We have the numbers. We've negotiated with them how many badges will the U.S. delegation get to get into the hotel? How many do they need? So we have the contacts, and if somebody asks to for us to put them in touch with somebody else, we can help.
Mm. And how do they convince them? Like, do they go to demos on the floor, or do they say, okay, let's meet at my room, or let's meet at the floor, let's meet at the bar?
Look, the logistical stuff is fascinating, but I'm actually curious what Leroy wants to ask.
Mr. Ishinger, you've been the whole weekend here at the MSC, and you already talked about some threats. And my question is, in your eyes, what are the top three threats, the top three challenges the world is facing today?
I think the number one threat, if you ask me as somebody who focuses on international relations, on foreign policy, on security, is that we seem to be sliding from what we thought was a world dominated by an international order with institutions and rules, what we call a rules-based international order. We're sliding from that. I hope I'm wrong, but I don't think I'm wrong. We're sliding into a world where, you know, not right makes might, but might makes right. In other words, where the strong dominate the discussion, where military pressure is used to coerce others, where, in fact, bloody conflicts happen all the time, where great power rivalries are growing in a way that makes me really scared.
Mm-hmm.
I find it terrible that mutual trust, which is, you know, trust is the currency of diplomacy. If there is no trust between a man and a woman, they're not going to marry, probably. But if there's no trust between the leaders of two countries, they will have a very hard time signing a piece of paper that's going to be sustainable and acceptable and accepted. So the lack of trust, the disappearance of trust, makes the world more dangerous. Just imagine one single occurrence, maybe, you know, some missile or some military instrument that goes wrong. And on the screen of somebody else, a blip shows up. And somebody says, they are attacking us. Do they have a number to call on the other side to figure out whether this is real or so? I hope they do. But my fear is that, you know, Russian generals don't know today their American counterparts. And that this guy in Syria, the leader of this group, does not know which number to call if he wants to stop shooting, and or ask the other side to stop shooting and wave the white flag. So we are entering into an even more dangerous phase for lack of trust, and because.
Are there any discussions about disarmament at the Munich Security Conference? Because
not enough, mm. Not enough. Clearly not enough. I mean, I'm sorry to say we should have tried. We tried, but not. Obviously not enough. We try to put the question of this new START treaty, which is expiring next year, we try to put that on the agenda. It's a bilateral thing between Russia and the United States. Mm. Did they talk about it? Not that I know of.
They have the opposite objective right now.
Voila. Mm. So that's very unfortunate. It's very unfortunate. And I think that Emmanuel Macron, the president of France, made a very, very important and correct point, because he said, we Europeans need to get our act together. You know, we need to speak with one voice and demand what is in our interest, namely not a new arms race, not more East-West confrontation, but hopefully more and better and more intense negotiations to get rid of all these many conflicts which surround us.
So Fonseca...
Sir, I just have a question. Is it okay? Or?
Well, we're about to do the rapid fire.
Okay.
So, yeah, so we don't want to...
We have to wrap up the conversation. Yeah. So we'd like to get a little bit more personal again.
Okay.
And here we have some really rapid answer questions. So who is the most inspiring politician for you?
Well, in the recent, let's say, last number of years, I was actually fascinated by President Obama. He inspired so many hundreds of thousands, millions of my own countrymen, even though he was president of a faraway country.
And now, please complete the sentence with just one word. In a perfect world, you are doing?
In a perfect world, I'm doing what I've always done, namely try to be a good diplomat and make sure that the perfect world will not turn into an imperfect and conflict-ridden world.
And could you, with just one word, describe the MSC? With just one word, how would you describe it?
Platform, informal and independent and nonpartisan platform for the resolution of conflict and for the creation of trust and peace.
Thank you so very much, Mr. Ischinger. And well, for those who are watching, don't forget that you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram using the hashtag YourMSC. Also, you can subscribe to this channel, hit that bell button so you will not miss any new post. I think we still have some more interviews coming. And as always, I think we see you next time.
Thank you again. Thank you, Mr. Ischinger. Thank you.
Cheers. Have a good one.
Fascinating. Great.
That was awesome. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Great.
You made a good job.
Take care. Bye-bye.
I think we are shooting some photos.
Yeah. What do you want to do?
I wanted to ask you, when two countries that they hit each other, like Azerbaijan and Armenia, how do they, is there any person in the middle in the room?
In this case, yesterday, these guys met two of them. The press.